a few words, we would like to conclude the first session. And now we'll move on to the next session, moderated panel discussion on CIN case scenarios. We have Dr. Prasanna Kumari ma'am, who needs no introduction, actually very favorite postgraduate teacher. Madam was the former head of the department of ONG at Calicut Medical College and Trivandrum Medical College. And she was the past president of K4G, has been served chairpersons of various societies of K4G. And Madam currently the president of Adur ONG Society and a senior consultant at Lifeline Hospital, Adur. And we have expert panelists. Dr. Lalitha Ambika ma'am, former professor and head of the department at Alappuzha Medical College, the department of ONG. And madam has retired very recently and enjoying the retired life. And we have Professor Emma from Regional Cancer Center, Trivandrum. And she has a lot of publications and activities in the cancer prevention and treatment. And we have Dr. Mumtaz. Mumtaz is the professor and at ONG department, MES Medical College, Perindalmanna, and a very active member of Perindalmanna ONG Society, and also our treasurer who keeps our finances intact. And we have Dr. Remya. Remya is the gynec-oncologist at Aster Hospital in Kottakkal. And when I invited Dr. Remya to this panel discussion, she said she's very much scared about Prasanna Kumari ma'am. And anyway, we'll see how the things will go ahead. And hope I didn't miss anyone. And with these words, I invite Prasanna Kumari ma'am for this panel discussion. Over to ma'am, please.
Thank you, Kunjimaydeen, for inviting me. Shall I share my screen?
Please, you can share.
I am in the hospital. My PG is there. So I should have a mask. I am in Lifeline. So my expert panelist Bandis will discuss how cervical pre-malignant lesion can be diagnosed and treated so that we will prevent cancer the cervix and eliminate cancer. So I am happy to see all of you. This Dr. Remya, actually, I'm not very familiar. Why? I don't know why she's scared of me.
Madam, I'm your student only, madam.
Where?
Calicut Medical College.
MBBS or MD?
MBBS, madam.
Okay. See, you need not be scared of me.
Not like that, madam.
Okay. So, cervical intraepithelial neoplasia is a pre-malignant lesion of the uterine cervix, and it is described as low grade and high grade. Low grade is LSIL and high grade is HSIL. And previously it was CIN 1, 2 and 3. I'll come to it. So, coming to cervical cancer, as we already said, it's a deadly but preventable, completely preventable. We can eliminate cervical cancer through intensified vaccination against HPV, screening and treatment. Let's say we are on to screening. What's the situation in India? It bears 1/5 of the world burden. 1,23,000 something is the new cases and some deaths around 70,000 per year, and ranks second leading cause of female cancer in women, and first leading cause of course is ear breast, and more than 3/4 of cases diagnosed locally in advanced stage, because every woman who comes with any complaint, as Lalavia said, opportunistic screening is not being practiced by everybody. Even a patient who is around 40 or 45 who comes with irregular bleeding is not being examined. See, when I was the KFO president, Koilon Society organized 16 camps, and for the inauguration I was there, and the lady collector was there. She was an young girl, and she was telling that her mother, when she was preparing for the UPSC exam, her mother, who is around 45 or 50, had irregular vaginal bleeding, and she went to several hospitals, and she was not examined. When she was examined, she was found to have an advanced CS cancer of the cervix, and she died. So that is the situation. It should not occur. We have to prevent it. So what about the situation in Kerala? Rema, how is the burden in Kerala at present? Rema, Dr. Rema is not there. Dr. Rema, see, the burden still is there. As Rema already said, in Kerala it is less, but still it is there. About 6 per 1 lakh.
6.8 per 1 lakh population.
Okay, 6.8 per 1 lakh. So we cannot forget Harold Sir Cosset, a Nobel laureate, for his landmark discovery that HPV virus is the cause of cancer research. That led to the invention of the vaccine. So this has been already explained by Gina. This is from my textbook. All women will be exposed to HIV, which is a ubiquitous virus. And depending upon several factors, only 5% finally lead to invasive cancer, depending upon so many other immunological factors, cigarette smoking, multiple sexual partners, etc., etc. The 5% finally will lead for AM grade 2, 3 CIS or invasive cancer. Well, that is the carcinogenesis, which is again already explained, the P53 and RB changes produced by the HPV virus. Histologically, premalignant squamous cell cervix was initially described as mild, moderate, and severe dysplasias. Histology is described the different nomenclature as cytology. And the cytology, in 1988, Bethesda system was introduced, and it was revised. Recently, it was in 2014 or 15. And different terminologies were used for cytology and histology, but it changed. CAN used to be described as CAN 1, 2, 3, but there's a change recently. The lower anogenital squamous cell terminology, the last terminology, is coined by the lower anogenital squamous terminology standardization project by the American Society for Colposcopy and Cervical Pathology and the American Pathology Society, the College of American Pathology. In the last system, cytological abnormalities are named in the nomenclature as histological abnormalities. There is no difference between cytology and histology. CAN1 is presently termed as LSIL. It includes histology as well as cytology. And CAN2 and 3 are termed as HSIL. And high grade could be cytology or histopathology. And because CAN 2 and 3, there is actually an overlap. And those who are P16 negative are not very highly, may not progress to malignancy, grade 3. So it is grouped under LSIL. And those who are P16 positive will be grouped as HSIL. So there are only two groups, LSIL and HSIL. What systems are used to classify lesions identified by cervical cytology? About cytology, let us ask Dr. Mundas. Mundas, can you describe the Bethesda system of reporting of cytology?
Yes, madam. Cytology, we are actually taking out the exfoliated cells. Whenever we do the pap smear, we are looking at the cells. in the cervix we can have two types of cells. One is the epithelial cell and one is the glandular cell. So because they have different nomenclatures to explain the degree of abnormality that one may come across, and they use abbreviations. Usually in medicine we say we shouldn't use abbreviations, but many times when we use undergraduates, but here there are a lot of abbreviations which we might see in the report the pathologist gives us. So it is important for us to know what are these things. So NILM means there is negative for intraepithelial lesion or malignancy. ASCUS is something we usually see when we see atypical squamous cells of undetermined significance. It is a little scary for us, but we shouldn't be scared of it. It is totally a harmless thing. But at the same time, the next category, atypical squamous cells, where one cannot exclude high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion, is something which should make us more vigilant. And we have the low-grade squamous lesion, which is called as LSIL, and high-grade squamous lesion, which is HSIL, and finally the squamous cell carcinoma. So we can think that it is progressing from the negative to the carcinoma. Likewise, if it's a glandular cell abnormality, we have the atypical glandular cells, and atypical glandular cells which may favor neoplasia, and also endocervical adenocarcinoma in situ. So these are the things that is usually of cervical origin, and sometimes you can see endometrial cells in women who are a little bit elderly, and also adenocarcinoma. So these cell malformations or abnormalities are possible with glandular cells. So regarding the management, madam, there are different things to follow, but we are following the most of the time FOXI management. And unsatisfactory smear is something we often get as a report. When the smear is unsatisfactory, if the HPV is available, it is better to go for HPV testing. And if it is negative, we can go for the routine screening. In case if it is positive, we need to follow the guidelines for the positive screening. But if HPV is not available, like most of us have no access to HPV testing, what should be done? There you can proceed with the colposcope. Madam? Repeat the cytology in 2 to 4 months, and if it is unsatisfactory, we can go for colposcopy. Again, if it is coming as unsatisfactory. But if in the repeat cytology, if you are getting ASCUS, then we have to more than ASCUS. We have to follow the guidelines. But in case if that is also not available, there is an option to do the visual inspection with the acetic acid. And if it is negative, of course, you can have the routine screening. And if it is positive, we need to follow the guidelines for the positive VIA. And if it is a low-grade, low squamous epithelial lesion, again, ideal is to do an HPV test and to look for whether it is positive or negative. And if it is positive, definitely to go for a colposcopy. If it is negative, we cannot just leave it like that. We need to repeat a core testing, that is HPV plus pap smear at 1 year. And then if the report comes as normal, we can continue with core testing repeatedly every 3 years. But in case, if the cytology is more than ASCUS, that is HSIL, or at any point the HPV becomes positive in our core testing, anytime, then it is an indication to do a colposcopy and guided biopsy. But if these things are not available, that is if HPV is not available, again, there's an option to do a colposcopy. And in some patients or in some situations, if the colposcopy is not available or you cannot refer the patient to a colposcopy center, there are certain situations where you can just see and treat, like if the if the lesion is confined to the cervix, if it is, there is no endocervical extension, if you are not suspecting malignancy in those situations. Now, this is about HSIL in women more than 30 years.
So it is, it's very important that you have HPV typing, you know. So instead of cytology, if you have HPV testing, it's much, much better, isn't it?
Yes.
It's much better to screen. What about RCC? Are you doing HPV routinely, HPV testing, Emma? Emma, are you there?
I'm there, madam.
What about HPV testing? Are you routinely doing HPV testing?
We are not routinely doing HPV testing now, but we used to do it as a part of project. Now we have got the machine and we are planning to start it as a proper screening program now. Can you hear me?
Is it that expensive?
Actually, we did it as a part of a project, and there was no expense to the patient. But the lowest expense that can bring down is around 500-600 rupees. But as of now, it is around 2000. Got that COBAS machine, and HPV testing will be started soon. Once you're doing it as on a large scale, depends on how many samples you can feed to the machine at a time. And so once you start doing in a large scale, the cost is definitely going to come down.
You need a liquid specimen, no?
Yes.
Yes, definitely.
And I think this TrueNAT platform for this COVID testing, it can be used for HPV testing, is it?
Yes, I'm just asking.
There are some private hospitals which use the TrueNAT testing, and they are doing it for something like between 1,500 to 2,000 rupees.
We have TrueNAT testing in Lifeline. We don't charge 1,500.
No, along with the psychology, madam.
Calicut also they are doing 1,200 is
all. Yes. I think after this COVID time, we can use this TrueNAT platform for HPV testing, which is much better. So what about high-risk types?
In high-risk category, we need to have a colposcopy and a guided biopsy. And if you can see, if you are thinking that the colposcopy is adequate, where you can visualize the entire transformation zone, then we are happy about it. Then we are happy about the biopsy. And if it is less than CAN or equal to CAN1, we can continue with co-testing, that is HPV plus pap smear. Or in some cases, we can also go for an ablation. But if it is CAN2 or 3, better to do an ablation. At the same time, if our colposcopy is not adequate, we are not able to visualize the transformation zone completely, again, it is better to go for an excision procedure or colonization, because HSIL or ACH has higher chances of becoming an invasive cancer. So in those situations, it is better to do a colonization. And depending upon the histopathology, we can see.
So you mean colonization, bold knife colonization?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Because you can't see the transformation, so it should be a bold knife colonization.
Those situations.
Can I add something, madam? Can I add something? Whenever possible, LEAP is an easier alternative for colonization. So LEAP is an outpatient procedure, and it's an easier alternative. It can be done as an OP procedure. Patient can go home after 10 minutes. Can do it under local anesthesia. So whenever possible, we can do LEAP also. So that's what we are practicing.
Transformation zone is not visible. Is it possible?
Transformation zone is not visible, then it should be a bold knife colonization.
No, ma'am. LEAP is a way of doing colonization. LEAP excisions are classified as type 1, type 2, and type 3. So type 3 excision with the LEAP is as good as a transfer, as good as a colonization. So here we are using a loop electrode to do a excision of transformation zone. So type 3 transformation zone, type 3 excision with LEAP is as good as a colonization.
Okay. And supposing abnormal glandular cells are present.
Abnormal glandular cells need a full excision of the cervix, and so we go for a colonization only.
And that is not LEAP. It is called.
You can do it with the needle cautery. So it's called a straight wire excision of the colonization of the transformation zone.
Okay. So when is an excision procedure preferred over? We have cryotherapy also, no? Thermal ablation, cryoablation.
Yes.
So when is an excision procedure preferred? I think let me answer.
We prefer an excisional procedure to an ablative procedure. In ablation, we don't get the tissue for histopathology. So a lesion that extends into cervical canal and cannot be fully visualized, we prefer an excisional procedure. And a lesion which covers more than 75% of the ectocervix and is beyond the reach of cryoablation. Endocervical curettage is positive for CAN2. And if the patient had previous excisional CAN2, that is recurrence, we prefer excisional procedure to ablative procedure. Again, if you find abnormal glandular cells in the smear, then also we should go for an excision procedure rather than ablative procedure.
Thank you.
Dr.
Typical endocervical cells. So what should you do? Abnormal glandular cells. We have to go for cold nebulization.
Definitely, ma'am. When there is abnormal glandular cells, we have to think about possibility of adenocarcinoma. So it is better to go for a colposcopy and guided sampling with endocervical.
Endocervical and endometrial.
Yes, ma'am.
Endometrial. It could be endometrial also.
Endometrial sampling. So in case it
even
that the scenario completely changes, we have to.
It is totally, but we have to keep in mind. Otherwise, we'll miss. And even malignant ovarian can also have typical also cells in this
cells.
So that we should not forget. So is HPV testing a better screening method? It cannot replace.
There are some recommendations for HPV as a screening method for CS cervix. We cannot consider it as a better screening method because it cannot replace cytology screening. It will only tell you whether HPV infection is present. It doesn't give you information on the presence or absence of precancerous lesion. Many HPV infections will clear spontaneously, almost 80%, especially in younger women less than 30 years. And we cannot take decision on management based on presence positivity of HPV alone. And HPV testing is associated with some false positivity and false negativity also. So unless we have the cytological or histological diagnosis, we cannot make a definite give a definite treatment.
It should have a validated test. Otherwise, it can be more false positivity and false negativity. And we'll go for it.
Unnecessary undergoing evaluation.
Undergoing evaluation, psychological stress of it.
Can I add something?
Yes.
HPV testing, if you look into the sensitivity and specificity, the sensitivity is around 70% and specificity is very high. It's around 90 to 95%. That means once you get a negative HPV, the need to screen the patient again will be after some 10 years or so. That's the advantage of HPV testing.
So that when is why they, all these charts give, you know, if you
only
a selective screen, you are okay. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Negative, you are okay. So when you do a PAP test and send the patient home telling that she is okay, means there is a 30% chance that she's not okay. So when you're selecting a screening test, you go by the sensitivity and specificity. And there definitely HPV testing has an edge over cytology and definitely over VIA. But the issue is cost. And as Madam pointed out, HPV testing is not the end of it. It should be rightly used. That is, when you're doing a HPV testing, you should do it in a patient who is more than 30. Because less than 30, the chance of HPV infection, which is transient, is very high. HPV persisting after 30 will be a higher risk to CIN. So HPV testing should be done only after 30. And definitely a triage of positive HPV test by cytology is needed. So just you are doing a primary screening program for the women in Kerala, definitely HPV testing has an edge once the cost is comes down.
We can think of doing HPV testing once or twice in a lifetime.
Yes, ma'am. So even once in a lifetime is good enough if you're selecting a screening test for that sake. But HPV testing is not the end of it. The positivity should be triaged by a cytology or VIA or colposcopy. That's an entirely different issue.
So what about VIA and VALI?
These are useful for downstaging and screening of cervical cancer in resource poor settings. And VAA or visual inspection with acetic acid is a naked eye inspection of the cervix in bright light, at least 1 minute after application of 3 to 5% acetic acid using a cotton swab, and looking for acetovite area in the transformation zone. Positive test is well-defined, densely opaque white lesion. That is important, well-defined, densely opaque. And based on the principle that dysplastic cells have more nuclear protein, which will be coagulated by acetic acid, and abnormal area will appear white and opaque. And advantages are that even trained health workers can do a screening with VAA in the periphery, and they can refer positive patients to higher centers. And even if we are doing it in our center also, we can take directed biopsy from acetovite area. It is having good low sensitivity, but some studies show as high as 96%. And specificity is also reported as 64 to 98%. But it has got a very good negative predictive value. If you don't find any acetovite area, that means the woman is unlikely to have abnormal lesion in the cervix. Next.
So very economic test, and can be done in the low resource setting, and we can train the paramedical staff to do it. And my classmate Shankar Narayanan has done a lot of work on this and published a lot of papers on this. Rema may be knowing.
VIE, and I believe I first started by Shankar Narayanan's project in RCC Trivandrum, headed by Ramani Desai Madam. And it's become quite popular. And it's a very useful technique because you can teach the paramedics and nurses or health workers, they can, even the ASHA workers can be trained to do VIE. So when we are selecting the screening test, it's not which one, we should be doing something, whichever is available. Now we have the Indian FOCSI guidelines. So it depends on where you're working and whatever facility available for you. If it is cytology, do cytology. If it's HPV, do HPV. If nothing is there, do VIE. The important thing is to do something. Don't wait for the HPV testing to come. Don't wait for the cytology facilities to improve. So whatever is there, start doing now. That's a policy now.
And yet another simple, easily available test is visual inspection with levosiride. Again, the principle is that natural cells have plenty of glycogen, so it will take up iodine and appear mahogany brown and multiply. So you can take biopsy from the unstained area. And sensitivity and specificity is almost same as VAE.
Thank you. Abnormal glandular cells favoring neoplasia, adenocarcinoma in situ, we have to evaluate the patient and manage. And it may be a cold cone biopsy if it is a typical glandular cells favoring neoplasia from the endocervix.
I think we already discussed this, madam, before you reach this slide. We have already discussed it. There can be cells from the endometrium and also some rarely from ovary and fallopian tubes also. So anyway, colposcopy and endocervical sampling and endometrial sampling is important. And depending upon the pathology of each only, we can proceed with the further management of these type of issues.
So always... that is how it, we lead on to hysterectomy. Otherwise, we will treat the patient with LEAP. If it is abnormal glandular cells, we have to think of more for hysterectomy. That's the message.
Yes.
So, but it's, you sometimes, usually we get a lot of findings like this, and lot of unnecessary hysterectomy is done. Yadambia may be knowing because... is in medical college service.
Definitely, we get a lot of requests for second opinion because somebody has advised hysterectomy for report a squamous metaplasia on the biopsy cervix. But actually, the squamous metaplasia means change of one type of epithelium to another. So what happens is, even as a physiological process during neonatal period, puberty, pregnancy, and whenever there is cervical infection, there will be epithelium will be converting from columnar epithelium to metaplastic. As a physiological process in the newborn, columnar epithelium is lining the cervix up to the fornix. and metaplasia takes place, and the columnar epithelium will be gradually converted to the squamous epithelium, and the original squamocolumnar junction, from original squamocolumnar junction to new squamocolumnar junction, that is called the transformation zone, where we get the squamous metaplasia. But this is quite physiological, and a biopsy report showing squamous metaplasia doesn't require any treatment. It's only one type of epithelium changing to another. Then in reproductive life also, sometimes due to cervicitis, erosion will occur. Columnar epithelium will overgrow the exocervix. Later on, metaplastic changes will occur, and that columnar epithelium will be converted back to squamous epithelium. So it is absolutely physiological, and it's not pre-malignant. That is the important thing we have to remember. It will not progress to malignancy. Then atrophic, inflammatory, all these are also totally benign and non-pre-malignant. In postmenopausal, you may get atrophic normal. Inflammatory may be due to trichomonas vaginalis infection or whatever, which may be seen in the smear itself, and we can treat accordingly. Again, reactive changes, sometimes reparative reactive changes secondary to infection, and after treatment of infection, we may get such cells. And the pathologist will be definitely capable of reporting or differentiating reactive changes from pre-neoplastic changes. So all these conditions do not require any treatment.
Other than infection. If it is reactive changes, when should you repeat a smear?
If it is reactive change, if you find any local infection or inflammation, you have to treat it. And after treating, you have to repeat it after 1 or 2 months. And sometimes it will be suspicious cells. If the report is suspicious cells, it may be useful to test HPV also.
So cytology and HPV will tell you whether abnormal cells are present or not, isn't it? And we have to locate where it is, and we have to confirm by histopathology before treating the patient, and we have to exclude invasive malignancy. So that is done by colposcopy, cervical histopathology. CIN, I think Dr. Ramya, can you explain what it is, CIN?
Cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, it refers to the histological diagnosis of the spectrum of changes in the squamous epithelium, which is known to be the precursors of squamous cell carcinoma. Earlier, the disease model was like the precursor lesions, which are progressing from mild to moderate to severe dysplasia and to carcinoma in situ and then to cancer. But the current cervical carcinogenesis model includes 3 steps, that is HPV infection, to progression to high-grade pre-invasive lesion and into invasion. Previously, the CIN was classified in the 3-tier system, the CIN 1, 2, 3. But now, after the last, that is the lower anogenital squamous terminology, all the HPV-associated histopathological lesions of the anogenital tract has been divided into two-tier system, that is low-grade.
It's already described. Let us talk about the guidelines, the management.
The updated guidelines for the management of cervical, this is the 4th updation of the ASCCP guidelines in 2019. So unlike the 2012 ASCCP guidelines that relied on the test results based algorithms, the new guideline is based on a risk based approach. That is, what is the underlying, what is the immediate risk of progression to CIN 3+, or what is the 5-year risk of progression to CIN 3+. So based upon the risk, so the risk is calculated based upon the previous screening report, previous screening results, or the current screening results, or the biopsy screening results, or age of the patient. All these things will be taken into consideration to assess the risk of the patient, and based upon the risk, the need for that will determine the need for surveillance, colposcopy, or treatment. So the guidelines recommend consideration of a patient's screening history along with the current test results to guide the clinical decision making. So for example, if the if the risk for progression to CIN 3+ is found to be more than 4%, then directly she has to undergo colposcopy and biopsy. But if the risk for progression to CIN 3+ is less than 4%, then she needs to continue screening. So how often she should do screening? Again, that is based upon the risk. For example, if the risk is less than 0.1%, then she needs to continue the routine screening at 5-yearly intervals only. But if it is between 0.1 to 4%, then she may has to do more frequent screening, either 1-yearly or 3-yearly. So everything is based on a risk-based approach. So, and the colposcopy can be deferred for certain patients. Like if the calculated risk for progression to CIN 3+, the immediate risk for progression to CN 3 plus is found to be more than 60%, then you can defer colposcopy and she can be guided for expedited treatment. So the guidance for expedited treatment is now expanded apart from the ACCP 2012 guidelines. For example, if a patient is HCL positive and HPV positive, so in that case, risk of progression to CN 3 plus, immediate risk of progression to CN 3 plus will be more than 60%. So in such a case, you don't need to do a colposcopy and biopsy. Instead, you can directly offer her treatment. So that is another change. And excision treatment is preferred to ablative treatment for histological HCL, CN 2 or 3. And excision is also recommended for adenocarcinoma in situ. For CIN1, observation is the preferred treatment. If it is, if the CIN1 is persisting for at least 2 years, then only you need to offer the treatment. Histopathology reports based on the last of the WHO recommendations for reporting the histological HCL should include CIN2 or CIN3 qualifiers. So it should be written as HCL CIN2 or HCL CIN3.
What is this? Colposcopy is not even needed for if it is CIN2, 3. Without the colposcopy or delineating the lesion, how can you excise the lesion?
There are some risk models, madam. So these risk models are based upon several factors. So based upon the risk models, if the inherent risk of the patient based on her underlying factors, that is
which tissue will you excise? See, something should be done for delineating the lesion. You said even if it is CIN 2, 3, you have advanced HSIL, you need not do colposcopy. So you should do something like VAL or VAN.
We can stay in
delineate the lesion. Otherwise, we cannot excise the lesion.
Yes, madam.
Madam, Dr. Ramya infos from doctors. It shouldn't be, you have a smear of HSIL and you have a colposcopy showing a high-grade lesion. You shouldn't do a biopsy. Tell the patient to come again with the biopsy report and then treat by LEAP or ablation or whatever. That's what meant by expedition of treatment. That means when a patient comes with a high-grade abnormality in the smear, we can do a colposcopy and all our treatment is colposcopy directed. In the same sitting, you do a colposcopy, you treat it by LEAP or colonization or whatever. That is expedited treatment. It's not avoiding colposcopy. It's avoiding colposcopy, biopsy, get the biopsy proof, and then treat. That's how we miss one stage. That's how we expedite the treatment.
We have to delineate the lesion before excision. That's it.
And all our treatments are, whatever it is, it's ablative or excisional, LEAP or thermal ablation or cryotherapy, it's all colposcopy guided. So here we do a colposcopy, treat in the same sitting. In another patient who has got a low-grade abnormality in the smear, we do a colposcopy, take the biopsy, confirm that the abnormality is there in the biopsy also, and the patient comes again for treatment. So that's 3-step and here it's 2-step. That's where the difference comes.
Okay, this is so.
And continuing, all the positive... All positive primary HPV screening tests, regardless of the genotype, should have additional reflex triage testing that should be performed from the same laboratory specimen or the reflex cytology. And continued surveillance with HPV testing or co-testing is demanded every 3 yearly. For what FOXI is recommending is we have to, once the reports return as normal, you can continue the normal screening protocols, that is 5-yearly HPV testing. But after treatment of high-grade histology for HCL, CIN2, 3 and adenocarcinoma in situ, the recent ACCP guidelines, they are in favor of continuing surveillance every 3 yearly for at least 25 years. And surveillance with cytology alone is acceptable only if testing with HPV or co-testing is not feasible. And HPV assays, which are FDA approved, should only be used for screening and for management. So if you don't have a validated HPV testing, the HPV test that has not been validated in the clinical trials, then you may have to combine with the cytology or co-testing has to be done. So that is very important in India, where we don't have validated tests, or we are not using validated tests. So primary HPV DNA testing.
That is so many so many laboratories will testing centers will approach us saying that they will do the SPV testing. So the validation is very, very important. Otherwise, it will be very high false positive and false negative. Okay. That is a risk of progression. Come on.
This is taken. This is taken from the FOXI GCPR guidelines only. So as you can see, there is.
Okay, proceed fast. Let us finish.
So this is taken from the FOXI guidelines. So you can see the risk of progression 5 years. So if the LCL cytology and HPV positive, you can see the risk of progression will be 6.1%. So based upon the risk of progression to CIN3 in 5 years, we can advise what next should be done. So for example, if the risk of progression to CIN3 plus is more than 5%, it is an indication for doing colposcopy. And if it is less than 0.1%, then you need to do routine screening only. So this is taken from FOXI.
So they are emphasizing that even if it is LSIL, if it is HPV positive, you have to go for colposcopy, isn't it?
Yes.
Risk of progression 5 years. Okay. Come on.
This is the same thing. We can see the risk from the slide. We can see the risk. So depending upon this, the risk only, we should advise how frequently the screening should be done, whether you need to do colposcopy at all. So that is the risk-based approach.
So coming to seeing the cervix, colposcopy, I think Rema can explain all this. We are not familiar with all these things.
Colposcopy, first of all, I want to tell you is it is not a screening test. But you have now recent handheld colposcopes which will help you in screening. But colposcopy is basically a confirmatory test. Whatever be your screening test, HPV abnormality, high risk HPV positive, your cytology showing anything more than LSIL, HSIL, ABCD, whatever, and your VIA showing positivity should be confirmed by a colposcopy. You never treat with a screening test. You treat after a confirmatory test. So the first step in colposcopy is, I beg to differ, we call it adequate colposcopy or inadequate. The unsatisfactory, satisfactory is an old terminology. The colposcopic nomenclature has now been standardized by the International Federation of Colposcopy and Cervical Pathology. You can refer the website of IFCPC. They put the new nomenclature and that calls it an adequate colposcopy if you are seeing the cervix like this, and you call it inadequate if you can't see the cervix due to whatever reason, let it be inflammation or bleeding or scarring. You can't see the cervix properly, you call it an inadequate. So that's the first thing you have to document, adequate. Then second thing is whether you can see the squama columna junction or not. Here, I don't have a pointer with me, but in the first picture, you can see the columnar epithelium is red and the squamous epithelium is pink. And madam is now delineating the squama columna junction. So that is well seen. So you call it a type 1 transformation zone when the squama columna junction is well seen. And now the second step is you put acetic acid, look for whitish lesions, and then you put iodine last. So here you can say, I'll report this colposcopy as colposcopy adequate, squama columna junction fully seen, type 1 transformation zone, and after acetic acid, nothing is there. So normal squamous epithelium, normal columnar epithelium, and my impression is a normal colposcopy. Do we have other pictures, madam?
This actually
needs some magnification to show the squama columna junction. From this view, you can call it as a colposcopy. Actually starts with the lowest magnification, that is INDU 4. What you are seeing in the second picture is an INDU 4, and in the first picture is an INDU 10 at least, when you get a magnified view. So from the INDU 4 view, it looks all normal. You are seeing a pale pink cervical epithelium. I'm not well seeing the squama columna junction, but probably will need some magnification. But no abnormality seen. Can we move on to this? Okay, here you are seeing a Yeah, colposcopy showing some reddish strawberry cervix typical of trichomonas vaginalis. So colposcopy is not just for the malignancy, you can also make out infections also. This is typical of trichomonas infection, strawberry cervix, you call it, reddish patches. Next picture, ma'am. Yeah, this is another colposcopy. So I'll report it as the adequate colposcopy because I'm seeing the cervix. Type 1 transformation zone, the squamous columnar junction, madam is showing it, it's well seen. And after acetic acid, there are a few faint acetovite areas that is in the transformation zone. When you're seeing an acetovite area, you have to see where you're seeing it, what's the extent. So you're seeing a faint acetovite area at 12 o'clock. You're seeing it extending from the 12 o'clock till some 5 o'clock, occupying some two quadrants of cervix. But it is a faint acetovite area. You're not seeing any atypical vessels or other vascular pattern, which we'll be showing in the next pictures. So here I will write it as a minor abnormality. Colposcopy adequate, type 1 transformation zone. Faint acetovite area occupying two quadrants extending from 5 o'clock to extending from 12 o'clock to 5 o'clock position with irregular margins. And my impression will be a minor abnormality. And I'll confirm by taking a biopsy from the most abnormal part of the lesion.
And depending upon the biopsy report only, you'll decide on B.
Yes, ma'am. Certainly, with the minor abnormality, I'll wait for the biopsy confirmation and then only I will treat. But suppose this patient came with the HSIL smear and I'm seeing a dense acetovite area, I can treat in the same sitting as my colposcopy. That's what we meant by expedited treatment. Treat in the same sitting.
That's the point. What about this one?
Yeah, ma'am. Here you are seeing a lesion which is going into the endocervix. It's it is more dense. It's got a slight more regular margin. See the margin, unlike the previous one, this has got a regular margin. Irregular margin will be like our margins of India, Sri Lanka. If you see something like that, you call it irregular. Here you have a denser lesion with regular margin. And probably on a closer, on a better magnification, you can make out some vascular abnormality also. But I wouldn't call it a condyloma because condyloma is an entirely different thing. When you're seeing a whitish lesion without acetic acid, you think about a leukoplakia condyloma. When you're seeing a whitish lesion after acetic acid, it's an acetovite lesion, which is suspicious of CIN. So I'll call it a low-grade abnormality. I'll take a biopsy from the most abnormal area. That will be the whitish area, which is inside the squamous column, which is towards the os, towards the columnar epithelium.
Supposing you are seeing a whitish area before painting with acetic acid.
That should be excised because you don't know what is underneath that. Like you treat leukoplakia, you should take biopsy from that lesion. So
what about this one?
Yeah, this I'll call a high-grade lesion because as you can see, it is a dense acetovite and there madam is pointing towards the vascular pattern, which is a coarse mosaic pattern. That is something like our mosaic chip. Probably new generation wouldn't know that, but it's like mosaic chips outlined by whitish areas outlined by reddish blood vessels. So that is suggestive of a high-grade lesion. And in the next picture, you can see dense acetovite area occupying all four quadrants, regular margins, dense acetovite area. So I'll call it a major lesion in my colposcopy. And I'll take a biopsy from this. And most probably the biopsy will come as HSIL or CIN3. Both are same now. So you'll get a high-grade lesion. And this definitely, if you're seeing this in your colposcopy, you're almost 100% sure that it's a high-grade lesion. The patient needs treatment, so do of a leap in the same sitting. Leap or conization, whatever, you can do in the same sitting. And this picture shows under magnification a few dilated, tortuous, abnormal vessels. So, and they're bleeding also. That's typical of an invasive carcinoma. So micro-invasive carcinoma, you don't do colposcopy when you're seeing a tumor, mind you, because with the tumor in the cervix, you don't have to do a colposcopy, you just take a biopsy. When the cervix is looking normal and your patient has got a smear showing HSIL or squamous cell carcinoma, you do a colposcopy. First and foremost, you look for these abnormal vessels. You can better delineate these vessels using a green filter in the colposcope. That will give you a green color and that will delineate the vessels better. and here you're seeing irregular vessels which are torches, which are bleeding also, and in between there are dense ascitovite areas also. So that's typical of a microinvasive carcinoma. Your biopsy report will be like invasive carcinoma.
From a lesion,
definitely biopsy. From a normal cervix, smear.
Yes, smear has no value in a lesion.
This is another cervix. You can't very well see the scamacolumnar junction. So I'll call it a type 2 because if I open up the cervix using a small cotton swab or endocervical speculum, I may see it. So colposcopy adequate, a type 2 transformation zone. The ascitovite areas involving all the four quadrants of cervix. It was faint and irregular at 12 o'clock and 3 o'clock. But when you come to 6 o'clock, you have dense ascitovite area and absent vessels. And so that looks like a high-grade lesion here. If you take biopsy from where madam is pointing, you'll get a CINT. So when you're seeing a lesion, take biopsy from the worst part of the lesion. Not from where it's accessible to you.
All these pictures are supplied from RCC. We should thank RCC for giving me the pictures.
That's another lesion. It's nice probably from a textbook, madam, because you are seeing a lesion and you are seeing another lesion inside that. So we used to call it a lesion within a lesion. The outer part is a fainter lesion, but inner part is a denser lesion. So this is a lesion within a lesion, and that is typical of a high-grade lesion. So that your biopsy will give you something like a CIN3. This is a typical feature of a high-grade CIN. Can you see cuff? What you're seeing there is a cuff glandular opening. You have the glandular opening. Madam, can you point towards the 5 o'clock position where you have acetovitis cuffed around a gland? Yeah. You have a glandular opening there, and acetovitis is heaped around the glandular opening. So again, that is a typical feature of high-grade CIN. You have a glandular opening, you know, is normal in the transformation zone where the columnar glands are, where the gland flips in the columnar epithelium is still there. But here you have acetovitis heaped around the glandular opening, and that's typical of high grade CIN. So you call it a cuffed glandular opening. So here you have a faint acetovite, irregular margin. Can you see that irregular margin at 11 o'clock? That lesion at 11 o'clock has got faint acetovitis, irregular margin, and it's in the transformation zone. So here the biopsy will come as LSIL or CIN1. And you can easily ablate this patient. Your ablation by cryotherapy or thermal ablation you can do for this patient, because this is typical of a low-grade lesion. For high-grade lesion,
but SPV testing need not be done if it is available.
No, ma'am. When you have a biopsy of CIN, you don't have to go for HPV testing because it is almost 100% 100%.
LSIL with HPV.
Yeah, ma'am. When you start on the yes, ma'am. When the patient comes to you with the screening report, suppose the screening report is ASCUS or LSIL. Your colposcopy facilities are limited. You can try it by doing a HPV testing. You do a HPV testing and make sure that the patient has got HPV. If high risk HPV is negative, you tell her to come back for cytology after 1 year. You can do cytology and HPV after 1 year. When you have a HPV testing is positive, you take her for colposcopy. So your HPV helps in triaging patient for colposcopy. So here you already done colposcopy, you're seeing a look. This is another high-grade lesion, dense acetovite involving all quadrants of cervix, regular margins. So this is typical of a high-grade lesion, CIN3. This is normal reproductive age females. You know that the columnar epithelium comes out and the scamacolumnar epithelium is well outside the external house. So what you're seeing there is normal. Under a colposcope, you're seeing normal squamous epithelium, normal columnar epithelium. Although in your visual inspection, it looked all red and angry. This is a normal finding. This is ectropion or normal cervix in a
reproductive. And these patients usually, they will come with complaints because they will have discharged baby.
Most probably reassurance is enough for these patients. Just make sure that nothing is there and leave her alone. Tell her that this is normal. another picture with invasive cancer. We already discussed dense acetovite vascular pattern. Everything is there in invasive cancer.
We'll come to some scenarios. 32-year-old lady, para 1, live 1, came for preconception counseling. She had a normal vaginal delivery 5 years back, followed by 2 spontaneous first trimester abortions. That's why she came for preconception counseling. No other significant history, and general examination was unremarkable. As a part of routine investigation, her cervical cytology was taken, which is come as HSIL. Of course, colposcopy will be done and biopsy was suggestive of HSIL, but the patient was lost to follow. Ideally, what should have been done for her when she comes as a HSIL? Ramya will answer. Ramya.
If a patient, this is the management of ASCH or HSIL. In a woman, 32-year-old, who is desirous of pregnancy, we have done the colposcopy and biopsy, and the report is CIN1 only, it's not CIN2-3, then we can repeat the cytology and colposcopy 6 monthly for 2 years. In between, if HSIL is persisting for 1 year, we have to repeat the cervical biopsy. If no CIN2-3, 6 monthly follow, but if ASCH or HSIL is persisting for 2 years, then we need to do the diagnostic excisional procedure. And if the repeat cytology and colposcopy 6 monthly for 2 years is negative, there is no high grade abnormalities in cytology and colposcopy, then she can return to age specific routine screening. In case the colposcopy and biopsy shows CIN2-3, then we have to follow the FOXI guidelines. For the for women with who are desirous of pregnancy, we do have the option of follow up of these women with the 6 monthly cytology and colposcopy.
You need not do a LEAP at the same time, no? You need not do LEAP because yes, the report is HSIL. No?
Yeah. You do have the option of follow up of these patients if she decides pregnancy and if it is CIN1. But if the abnormality is persisting for 2 years, then we have to go for a diagnostic excisional procedure. In CIN2-3 woman desirous of pregnancy, we have to review the colposcopy if it is satisfactory or unsatisfactory. If it is an unsatisfactory colposcopy, then definitely we have to go for an excisional procedure. But if it is satisfactory colposcopy, we do have the option of follow-up with cytology and colposcopy 6 monthly, and the lesion is persisting, then repeat cytology and colposcopy 1 year. Once the cytology is negative or it is improving and colposcopy is normal, then we can repeat the core testing 1 more year. And if it is again normal, then we need to repeat 3 years and following that 5 years. But in case any abnormal reports in between, that is repeat cytology and colposcopy at 1 year has become still high grade cytology or the colposcopy worsens, then we have to treat using the excision or ablation procedure. So we can opt for excision or ablation. If the criteria for ablation if there is a criteria, if she's eligible for ablation, then we can go for an ablation procedure. That is the lesion is located within the ectocervix, it is not having any endocervical or vaginal extension, and if it is not extending to more than 2/3 of the cervix, and if there is no suspicion of invasion, then we do have an option of ablation in CIN2-3.
Okay. So this unsatisfactory should be replaced by inadequate. Is it in Reba?
Yes, ma'am.
And CIN1 histology in woman desirous of pregnancy, the CIN1 histology can be, before that we have to review the cytology report. If it is preceded by ASCH-HSIL or ASCH-HSIL. If it is preceded by ASCH-HSIL, we need to repeat the cytology at 1 year. We do have the option of follow-up of CIN for 2 years with the cytology, HPV testing, cytology or core testing. And if at the end of 2 years, if the CIN1 is persisting, then we need to go for treatment. But if it is preceded by ASCH or HSIL, we repeat the cytology and colposcopy at 6 monthly intervals. If there is any suspicion of invasive disease, we have to manage accordingly. But if there is no if it is not suggestive of any invasive disease, we need to repeat the cytology and colposcopy at 1 year. So at 6 months and 1 year, after that, if still the ASCH or SM is persisting or the high grade lesion is persisting, then we need to go for the diagnostic excision procedure. But if it returns to ASCH or LCL, we can follow the same management as of here. So CAN1 persisting for 2 years only requires treatment if it is preceded by ASCH or LCL. If CAN1 is preceded by ASCH or LCL, it's better to go for a treatment. But if she decides pregnancy, we do have the option of follow-up.
Are we following this protocol, Emma? Even if it is HSIL, we don't do a deep, no, we'll go on doing colposcopy, is it?
Yes, ma'am. Now we have the Indian guidelines. COFSI has brought out the excellent guidelines. So this is particular area of our medicine where you have excellent guidelines by the Indian team. So this is in par with the international guidelines. What I'd like to emphasize is when you plan treatment for CIN, the first and foremost, you think about a desire for pregnancy because you don't want to amputate and destroy your cervix and cause complications like preterm labor and all other infertility issues. So that's first and foremost you should bear in mind. Second thing is, what is the cytology? If you already have a cytology, if it is a high-grade abnormality, more likely she is going to have a lesion which is going to need treatment. So even when the woman is having a high-grade abnormality in the smear and your colposcopy is CIN high-grade, we know that CIN high-grade doesn't progress to cancer in 1 or 2 years. It will be at least 5 years. So you give her some space so we can strictly follow her up. And although these guidelines look confusing in one look, if you have a patient and you can just triage to wherever your patient fits, it's all clear. So you can triage the patient for a follow-up with a 6-monthly cytology and of course colposcopy. And if the lesion is persisting at the end of 2 years, you can treat them. Meanwhile, you can definitely allow her to get the pregnancy and in the waiting period. So when a patient who is desirous of pregnancy, you think before you treat.
After 8 months, he came to annual OPD with 20 weeks pregnancy, is conceived, and she wanted to continue the pregnancy. Of course, definitely we'll be doing a colposcopy for her, and it was a satisfactory colposcopy. And the report is HSIL. Directed biopsy report is HSIL. And will you do something during pregnancy?
No, ma'am. We know that CIN, high grade CIN, doesn't progress to cancer in a few weeks or months. So we are justified in doing a colposcopy and making sure that there is no frank invasive cancer. So definitely we should be doing colposcopy during pregnancy. It's technically difficult because the cervix is very vascular and it's very difficult also. I mean, it's difficult to make out a lesion, but you should do a colposcopy, take a biopsy. Biopsy also you can safely take during pregnancy. The bleeding will be slightly more than a normal cervix, but again it can be controlled. So colposcopy biopsy done and the report is HSIL, definitely you can wait. Don't disturb a pregnancy, don't treat now. Let her deliver and she should come back at 6 weeks or even 3 months is safe enough and then treat.
So she has come back. So that is how you follow. It's already described.
Yes.
6 weeks post delivery, it's again HSIL. But no invasion.
Yes.
Bone biopsy was done, which again showed HSIL. Bone margins were free and she was followed up. And then you will take the routine follow.
The management of CIN in pregnancy, as Rema Madam told, there is no need for active treatment in pregnancy for precancerous lesions. So in pregnancy, we review the colposcopy report for adequacy. And if it is a low-grade lesion, we need to follow up only at 6 weeks postpartum. There is no need to follow up during pregnancy. But if it is a high-grade lesion, we need to repeat the colposcopy in each trimester. And if you suspect any invasion, you may take a biopsy. Otherwise, there is no need for biopsy. If there is invasive disease only, then we have to treat. Otherwise, we need to review and treat at 6 weeks postpartum.
So that is, to sum up, reported abnormal smear during pregnancy is 1 to 8%. 8% is too much. follow-up should be similar to non-pregnant stage, and regardless of gestation, suspicious lesion should be biopsied. And cervical biopsy does not increase the risk of miscarriage. Biopsy will not increase, but LEAP excision might increase. There is no evidence of invasive cancer, don't disturb. So this is something which I wanted to show because I have seen 2-3 times like this. It looks like a cancer, no? But we have taken biopsy also. It comes as residualization. Have you seen it? Sometimes you'll see, no? We have seen it 2-3 times. So coming to the second scenario, it's a 45-year-old lady came for routine checkup. The liquid pap test was abnormal. She had a pap test done 10 years back and the result was LSIL, but she didn't come for follow-up. Patients are like that only. So HPV co-testing at that time, it was HPV type 16 positive. So how do you manage LSIL HPV positive? Rema?
Yes, ma'am. We have a smear of LSIL, that's a low-grade abnormality, and we have a HPV positive. With a smear only, we can go for HPV testing. If HPV is negative, we can repeat smear after 1 year. If HPV is 16 positive, which is a high-risk HPV, we'll go for colposcopy. So we'll do a colposcopy, take a directed biopsy in colposcopy, and treat depending on the biopsy report. If biopsy report is normal, the patient returns back to patient needs to be assessed only after 1 year with a repeat smear and HPV. The biopsy shows a low-grade abnormality like CIN1. We know that CIN1 can regress back to normal in a large percentage, around 60 to 70% regress back to normal.
45 years, no? This lady is 45 years.
The risk of regression is slightly less compared to a 30-year-old. But still, you have no harm in following her up. So CIN1 can be safely followed up for 2 years, if it's persisting at the end of 2 years, or if it's progressing to CIN 2 and 3, we can treat her now. Then CIN 1 regression is lesser in a woman in her 40s, but still we can go for a careful follow up with cytology and colposcopy every 6 months and treat if it is persisting or progressing at the end of 2 years.
Because she is 45, even if it's LSIL, we can do some ablative procedure, no?
The criteria for ablation is low-grade histopathology, and it should be a type 1 transformation zone. The lesion should be should not be extensive. It should be there in only one or two quadrants. Then we can offer an ablation.
Even if it is HSIL, you need not do hysterectomy, isn't it?
Definitely no hysterectomy.
But so many hysterectomies are being done for even LSIL.
Issue with hysterectomy is you are not just over-treating the patient. Instead of doing a small OP procedure, you're doing a surgery under anesthesia, which is definitely over-treatment. But at the same time, you are under-treating the patient because your excision procedure would have revealed an area of micro-invasive cancer. Suppose there was a high-grade abnormality. Seeing an HSIL smear and a CIN3, you're done a hysterectomy. But there was an area of invasive cancer and she needed radical hysterectomy. You have under-treated her. Now you can't do, and you have to go in and do a parametrectomy with lymphadenectomy depending on the depth of invasion. So hysterectomy is sort of under-treating and over-treating at the same sitting. Even if you're planning a hysterectomy, do a colonization first. Make sure that there is no invasive carcinoma and your colonization is enough for the patient. So hysterectomy is practically not done for CIN. Should not be done for CIN.
This is the only thing. Because of this only I brought this situation. Because if you have to exclude an invasive cancer before you do hysterectomy. And don't do unnecessary hysterectomies. If a corn biopsy or a LEAP is sufficient, it should be done. It should not over-treat patients.
Yes, ma'am.
Coming to what should have been the advice, ACCP guideline, advice, colposcopy, I all discussed. And she was scheduled for immediate colposcopy and LEAP. And it was CIN2 HSIL. So even if it's HSIL, you need not do hysterectomy. You repeat, you do a quad biopsy. You do colposcopy, you do biopsy, and depending upon the biopsy, you do. It has been already discussed. And this is the large loop excision of the transformation zone. I'll start from here. So then I will explain how you do a deep. It's nicely seen, a nice video.
Leap is done using some loop electrodes, and it's done under local anesthesia. The here we are giving local anesthesia, which is using a long spinal needle and lignocaine with adrenaline, and it's done given all around the cervix because you don't want the patient to move when you're doing the procedure. So give in abundance local anesthesia all around the transformation zone. Do a colposcopy, delineate your lesion, and see you, we are using insulated speculums. Because you are using cautery, you don't want the cautery to touch the vaginal wall and the patient will develop a burn. So we are using insulated speculums, and you also need a suction. Can you see the white thing at 12 o'clock on that speculum? That's actually a suction which will suck out the smock. That's very important because once you start cutting, it's just like a laparoscopy. But here your vision is a little more limited and your smock will come and occlude your field. So you want to remove the specimen in one piece. You have to do a continuous cut. So you need a suction there. So you are given local, wait for 2 minutes for the local to act. And that's a loop electrode coming. Can you see that here is a horizontal bar and a loop which is going to cut. Once you activate the cautery, it works in the same theater cautery. And once you activate the cautery, it goes and cuts the cervix. The horizontal bar will make sure that you don't go too deep. So you can select the loop according to the depth you want to excise. So you start from one side and go to the other side, right to left or left to right, left to right or whatever, whichever you are convenient, or even from above down. And now you are excised. That's over. The patient is not moving. So you can again, you can see the crater. So your crater should be half moon shape. You can see a circular crater right there, right? You don't want the crater to be deep in the edges. So when you move the loop, you go deeper as you move. And when you withdraw also, you make it shallow when you take out the loop. So here we are planning another excision because probably it didn't confirm the whole of, you're doing it under colposcopy and so some transformation zone is left behind. So another excision at 12 o'clock position, and that's also removed. So you call it a multiple pass procedure. Depending on the size of the cervix, the extent of lesion and the type of transformation zone, you can plan your excision. So now the crater is slightly bleeding. You do it under a cutting current. You do the cutting under a cutting current, and now you're coagulating. You can see that ball electrode. There's a small 3 millimeter ball at the tip of the electrode, which is a spraying current. It's done by a procedure called fulguration when you don't really go and touch the cervix. You just spray the current on the cervix. So you're wiping the blood and fulgurate the cervix. Yes. Okay. So it's a simple procedure, 10 minutes. The patient can walk in. You do it under local. Tell her to sit on a chair for half an hour and go to the toilet and go home. Give her a course of antibiotics. That's all. So LEAP is actually a very simple procedure compared to all the procedure that we gynecologists are doing. So it's nothing great in that.
So we should all start.
Everybody should be doing, ma'am.
And this specimen showed HSIL with margins negative. And margins negative means this treatment is over. And suppose if the margin is positive, what should you do?
Okay, ma'am. The margins, I have not shown the complete excision after complete coagulation. Once you excise and coagulate for hemostasis, you keep on coagulating in the margin also. You coagulate a few millimeter beyond that crater. So your margin positivity is concerning depending on which margin. If your endocervical margin is positive, it's concerning. Patient needs a repeat excision. You can do a repeat LEAP then. If the ectocervical, if the outer margin is positive, you are coagulated even beyond that margin. So you coagulate some 0.5 centimeter all around the crater after that excision. So your outer margin positivity is not concerning, but your inner or endocervical margin positivity needs a re-excision.
Okay.
or a close follow-up. Patient can also opt for a close follow-up.
So this is another situation where a 28-year-old multipara has come with the postcoital bleeding and cervix is bleeding to touch. There is mucocurulent discharge. So I think it is Lalithambhia's patient.
So here, there is obvious cervicitis is there. So before taking a pap smear, we should treat the infection. You can use doxycycline plus local codeine. Wait for 1 to 2 weeks. Once the infection is controlled, we can take either a conventional pap smear or a code testing, which is available. And if it comes as HPV positive and LSIL, since she is 38-year-old, the chance of spontaneous regression is less compared to a younger than 30-year-old lady. So we can do a colposcopy and biopsy if required. If colposcopy is, doesn't show any abnormality, we can just follow her up. And so if HPV is negative, risk of progression is very low. So HPV negative, any lady requires only follow. But if LSIL persists after 24 months, we have to do colposcopy and treat accordingly. And the colposcopy biopsy shows if it is HSIL and adequate colposcopy, we can treat it immediately. CN treat policy can be adopted, LEAP can be done. If the margins are incomplete, either we can do a repeat LEAP or a cold cone biopsy can be done. After cone biopsy, the histopathology examination should be meticulous to know if cone margin is free. And actually, there is no place for hysterectomy, though many women with HSIL or even LSIL are undergoing hysterectomy. It should not be done for LEAP because already Dr. Rama has explained, sometimes it may be under treatment or it may be an over treatment. So hysterectomy should be reserved to situations where you have adenocarcinoma in situ or atypical glandular cells, where you may have sometimes go for hysterectomy. And cold cone biopsy can be done if colposcopy is inadequate or the margin is not free of lesion. And we have already discussed if pap test is not available, we can do VAN directed biopsy.
With something, don't do a multiple punch biopsy. Somehow you delineate the abnormal area and take the biopsy.
These women have to be followed up.
Even if you are doing a hysterectomy for HSIL, then after hysterectomy, what smear follow up will be done? So what about cryopauterization?
So ablation procedures. Regarding ablation procedures, okay, as well as excision procedures. So ablation procedure, the problem is we don't get this sample for histopathology. So it is done on definite indication only. Cryotherapy is commonly done. It will destroy the surface epithelium by crystallizing intracellular water, resulting in eventual destruction of the cell. We require either nitrous oxide, which cools to minus 89 degrees centigrade, or carbon dioxide, minus 65, which will create on the surface we are dealing with minus 20 to minus 30 degree temperature. That is required for effective destruction. A freeze-thaw technique should be used. Ice ball will be achieved in 5 millimeter beyond the edge of the thaw. So you have to do 2 sequential freeze-thaw cycles, 3 minutes for freezing and 5 minutes for thawing. And after the second thawing, the probe should be removed very slowly. And it can be done for CAN2 or 1 persisting more than 24 months. But the lesion should be small and it should be located entirely on the ectocervix, negative endocervical sampling, and no endocervical gland involvement in biopsy. That it should be a type 1 squamocolumnar junction.
Only for LSIL, is it?
Even with HSIL, we can do ablation, but excision is preferable because we don't get the, if you don't have the specimen, we can do, but it should be a small lesion, less than 1 centimeter, should be confined to the ectocervix. That is, this coma-columnar junction should be clearly visible.
So this is another lady, infertility treatment, random punch biopsy.
Yes. We should never do a random punch biopsy because we can miss even an invasive cancer. So once she had a random punch biopsy, we should do a colposcopy, or if the facility is not available, at least we should try to localize the lesion by leucocytosine or acetic acid and then take a directed biopsy.
Opportunity screening the 30-year-old woman reported as NILM but HPV positive.
So here the problem is, in less than 30-year-old woman, HPV clearance is very common. Up to 80% will clear. So very few will progress. So we can repeat co-testing after 1 year because cytological abnormalities are not found out. And only if it persists for more than 24 months, we need treatment.
If it is ASCUS?
ASCUS, we can do co-testing. And if HPV negative, risk of developing CAN2 or more is less than 1%. If HPV positive, the risk will be almost 18%. So we have to do a colposcopy and proceed further.
So let us make cervical cancer prevention our daily habit, and let us promote vaccination. Let us make HPV testing a routine as far as possible, and adopt a screen and treat policy rather than a see and treat policy. Because the patient need not come several times to the clinic. VALIN, VAA, in poor resource setting we could use. And we should empower our health workers to do that. And let us make our country cancer-free. I thank all the panelists who have done a very good job. I thank you, Shama, thank you, Elizabeth, thank you, Das, thank you, Ramya. I hope you enjoyed Ramya. You still care of me.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the panel.
Thanks very much.
You included everything, and the priority of cervical cancer prevention should be there in all of us. And so your panel will be very useful.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a very, really wonderful panel with a lot of nice colposcopy pictures. And we have a very good number of audience delegates. Still waiting to attend this meeting. So it's a really good one, and a lot of good comments coming up. And I think without much doubts, you could clear everything, and all the panelists were so good. And thank you so much. And with this, I would like to invite Dr. Gina to say a few words about, she wants to tell something about the activities which she is planning. Dr. Gina, are you there online?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Prasanna ma'am, can you stop sharing?
Thank you, Punjimadhan, for giving me this opportunity for talking at last minute. And madam, enikkeppom parayanullad namukku engineengilum this dream scan ഒരു റിയാലിറ്റി ആക്കണം. അപ്പൊ നമുക്കത് എച്ച് പി വി വാക്സിനേഷനും എച്ച് പി വി സ്ക്രീനിങ് ഇത് സെർവിക്കൽ ക്യാൻസർ സ്ക്രീനിങ്ങും എല്ലാവരും ചെയ്തിട്ട് അത് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ കൊണ്ടുപോയി നമുക്ക് ഈ ഇപ്പം ഡോക്ടർ ജമ പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ നമ്മളുടെ ഇൻസിഡൻസ് ഇപ്പൊ 6.8 ആണെങ്കിൽ ഇപ്പം എലിമിനേറ്റ് സെർവിക്കൽ ക്യാൻസർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് ലെസ് ദാൻ 4 per 100,000 പോപ്പുലേഷൻ. ഇത് രണ്ട് മാത്രം കുറഞ്ഞാൽ മതി. അപ്പൊ നമ്മൾ നന്നായിട്ട് പ്രയത്നിച്ചാല് എല്ലാവരും കൂടെ ഒന്നിച്ച് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഇത് നമുക്ക് ഈ എലിമിനേഷൻ 2030 മുന്നേ തന്നെ നമുക്ക് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്ന കാര്യമില്ല. പക്ഷെ എല്ലാവരും അതിന് ഒന്നിച്ച് സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്യുകയും വാക്സിനേഷന് വേണ്ടി പബ്ലിക് അവയർനെസ് മാക്സിമം നമ്മൾ കൊടുക്കണം. അപ്പം ഓരോ സൊസൈറ്റി നമ്മൾ ചെയ്യുന്നതൊക്കെ ഒരു ഒരു മാസം നമ്മൾ എത്രയും ചെയ്തു നിൽക്കുന്ന ഒരു ഡയറ്റ് ഒന്ന് പ്രൊമോട്ട് ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അത് ഓരോരുത്തർക്കും ഒരു അടുത്ത സൊസൈറ്റിക്കും എല്ലാവർക്കും ഒരു ബൂസ്റ്റ് ഒരു എന്താ പറയാ നല്ലൊരു എൻകറേജ്മെന്റ് ആവും. അപ്പൊ അങ്ങനെ നമുക്കത് നോക്കിയാലും ഇത് ഏതെങ്കിലും രീതിയിൽ നമുക്ക് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്നാണ് എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നത്. പിന്നെ ആദ്യം നമുക്ക് നമ്മുടെ ഫാമിലികളിലുള്ളവരെയൊക്കെ തന്നെ ഒന്ന് സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്യാം, കുട്ടികൾക്ക് വാക്സിനേഷൻ എടുക്കാം. അറ്റ്ലീസ്റ്റ് നമ്മൾ ഒരു ദിവസം നമ്മുടെ ഹോസ്പിറ്റലിൽ വരുന്ന ഒരാളെ അറ്റ്ലീസ്റ്റ് രണ്ടോ മൂന്നോ പേരെങ്കിലും ഒന്ന് സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ തന്നെ നമുക്ക് ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റി സ്ക്രീനിങ് രീതിയിൽ കുറേ കാര്യങ്ങൾ നമുക്ക് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ എനിക്ക് സ്ക്രീൻ പോസിറ്റീവ് തന്നെ വളരെ കുറച്ച് നമുക്ക് വരുത്തും. 100 പേരെ സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഒന്നോ രണ്ടോ ഒരാളോ എന്നോ രണ്ടോ പേര് സ്ക്രീൻ പോസിറ്റീവ് ആയിട്ട് കിട്ടും. അവരെ നമുക്ക് ട്രീറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ എന്തായാലും മെഡിക്കൽ കോളേജിലുണ്ട്, RCCയിൽ വിടാം, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ചെയ്യുന്നിട്ട് ഏകദേശം കുറെ ആൾക്കാർ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ചെയ്യാം, ഇല്ലെങ്കിൽ HPV ടെസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്ത് നോക്കിയിട്ട് അത് കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ചെയ്ത് ബയോപ്സി എടുത്തിട്ട് ഇപ്പൊ ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ് മൊഡാലിറ്റീസ് എല്ലാം നമ്മൾ നോക്കിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. ആ രീതിയിൽ ചെയ്യാം. നമുക്ക് ഈ സെൻസിറ്റൈസേഷൻ ഞാൻ പറയാം, നമ്മുടെ ഡോക്ടേഴ്സിന്റെ ഇടയിൽ ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റിന്റെ ഇടയിൽ ഒന്ന് സെൻസിറ്റൈസ് ചെയ്യാം. എന്നിട്ട് നമുക്ക് പബ്ലിക് അവയർനെസ്സും കൊടുത്താൽ എല്ലാവരും കൂടെ ഒന്നിച്ച് ചേർന്ന് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഇത് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമെന്നാണ് എൻ്റെ ഒരു ആഗ്രഹം. എനിക്കിത് എന്താ പറയാ, എല്ലാവരും ഇതിനു വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് സഹകരിച്ച് നമുക്കിത് നല്ല രീതിയിൽ കൊണ്ടുപോകണം. മാഡത്തിന്റെ അഭിപ്രായങ്ങളൊന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാലും നന്നായിരിക്കും. എല്ലാ ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റുകളും ഒരു 3 കേസ് ഒരു ദിവസം നമ്മളൊന്ന് സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്യാൻ തന്നെ നമുക്ക് കുറെ ആവൂലോ. VIA നമുക്ക് നമ്മുടെ സിസ്റ്റേഴ്സിനെ പഠിപ്പിച്ചു കഴിഞ്ഞാല് സൂപ്പർവൈസ് ചെയ്താൽ മാത്രം മതി. എന്തെങ്കിലും ഒരു സ്ക്രീനിങ് മൊഡാലിറ്റി നമുക്ക് എന്താ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്ന ആ സ്ക്രീനിങ് മൊഡാലിറ്റി ചെയ്യാം.
ഡെഫിനറ്റ്ലി നമ്മുടെ ട്രഡീഷണൽ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പ് വിച്ച് കംസ് അറൌണ്ട് ഒരു ലെസ് ദാൻ 1 ലാക്ക്, അതാണ് ഹോസ്പിറ്റലിന് ബെസ്റ്റ്. ആനുവൽ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പ് അതിന്റെ ഒരു ഈസിയർ ഓൾട്ടർനേറ്റീവ് ആണ്. ഇപ്പൊ മൊബൈലിലോട്ട് ലിങ്ക് ചെയ്തിട്ട് റിപ്പോർട്ട് തരുന്ന ആർട്ടിഫിഷ്യൽ ഇന്റലിജൻസ് ഓപ്ഷൻസ് ഒക്കെ ഉണ്ട്. അപ്പം മറ്റേ ട്രഡീഷണൽ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പ് തന്നെയാണ് ഈസിയസ്റ്റും ടൈം ടെസ്റ്റഡും. ആനുവൽ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പ് കുറച്ച് പുതിയതാണ്.
നമുക്കിത് ഇംപ്ലിമെന്റ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിൽ ചെറിയൊരു സപ്പോർട്ട് ഗവൺമെന്റ് സൈഡിൽ നിന്ന് വേണം. ഇപ്പം ഹെൽത്ത് സർവീസിലെ ഹോസ്പിറ്റലുകളിലാണ് മെജോറിറ്റി ലേഡീസ് ഓരോരോ ആവശ്യത്തിന് പോകുന്നത്. പക്ഷെ അവിടെ എങ്ങും ഇങ്ങനെ ഒരു കാര്യമേ ഇല്ല. ഈവൻ CA സർവീസ്
ഒബ്വിയസ്ലി
അവിടെ അതിന് സൗകര്യമില്ല. ദേ ഡോണ്ട് ഹാവ്, അവർക്ക് ആ ഒരു റുട്ടീൻ ശീലമില്ല. അതാണ് അത് നമ്മളൊന്ന് ഇംപ്ലിമെന്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ ഒന്ന് ഇൻസിസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്ത് ഗവൺമെന്റ് സൈഡിൽ നിന്ന് ഒരു സപ്പോർട്ട് വരണം. ഹെൽത്ത് സർവീസിൽ പോണം. ഹെൽത്ത് സർവീസ് സൈഡിലാണ് നമ്മളിപ്പോ മെഡിക്കൽ കോളേജുകളിൽ എല്ലാവർക്കും റുട്ടീൻ സ്മിയർ എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നു എല്ലാ മെഡിക്കൽ കോളേജിലും എടുക്കുന്നുണ്ട്. ഹെൽത്ത് സർവീസിലാണ് കൂടുതൽ പേഷ്യൻസ് പോവുക. അപ്പൊ അവരെ ഒന്ന് മോട്ടിവേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത് കുറച്ചുകൂടെ ഒരു സ്പെക്കുലം നോക്കാൻ
ബാരൽ
ഷേപ്സ് ചെയ്യുമ്പോ നമുക്ക് ബൾക്കി
മാഡം. അതുപോലെ HPV ടെസ്റ്റിംഗ് നമുക്ക് ഈ കോവിഡിന് യൂസ് ചെയ്ത റിസോഴ്സസ് ഹോപ്പ്ഫുള്ളി പാൻഡമിക് ആ ജീൻ എക്സ്പേർട്സും ട്രൂനായിട്ടും എല്ലാം യൂസ് ചെയ്ത് HPV ടെസ്റ്റിങ്ങിന് പറ്റും. പക്ഷെ അങ്ങനെ നമ്മൾ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ വി നീഡ് ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റ് ടു കം ആൻഡ് ട്രീറ്റ് ദി പേഷ്യൻസ്. ഇത്രയും നമുക്ക് സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്യാനുള്ള ഫെസിലിറ്റീസ് ഓൾറെഡി കോവിഡിന് വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ആയിട്ടുണ്ട്. ആക്ച്വലി ഹെൽത്ത് സർവീസിലെ കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ഫെസിലിറ്റീസ് ഉണ്ട്. മെജോറിറ്റി ഡിസ്ട്രിക്ട് ഹോസ്പിറ്റൽസിലും പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യുന്നില്ലെങ്കിലും കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ഫെസിലിറ്റീസ് ഉണ്ട്. ഇനി നമ്മൾ ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റ് മുന്നോട്ട് വന്നിട്ട് അതിന്റെ ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റും കൂടെ അങ്ങ് സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്യണം. കോൾപ്പോസ്കോപ്പി ചെയ്ത് തുടങ്ങണം, പിന്നെ ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റും കൂടെ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്യണം എന്നുള്ള ഇതേ ഉള്ളൂ. സ്ക്രീനിങ് നമുക്ക് ഉടനെ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. വാക്സിനേഷൻ അതുപോലെ പ്രോഗ്രാമായിട്ട് നമുക്ക് കൊണ്ടുവരാൻ പറ്റും. ആക്ച്വലി സെർവൈക്കൽ ക്യാൻസറിന്റെ ഇൻസിഡൻസ് കുറയണു എന്നുള്ളൊരു ഇതാണ് ഗവൺമെന്റ് എപ്പോഴും ഒരു അതിന്റെ ഒരു നമ്പേഴ്സ് ഓഫ് ക്യാൻസേഴ്സ് നോക്കിയിട്ടാണല്ലോ പ്രയോറിറ്റൈസ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. പക്ഷെ അത് എപ്പിഡമിയോളജിക്കലി സ്പീക്കിംഗ് ശങ്കരനാരായൺ സാറിന്റെ ഒക്കെ ഒരു ഹൈപ്പോത്തസിസ് വട്ട് എവർ ഫോൾ വി ആർ സീയിങ് നൗ മേ കം ബാക്ക്. ഇപ്പോ നമ്മൾ ഡ്യൂ ടു നമ്മൾ സ്ക്രീൻ ചെയ്തിട്ടല്ല സെർവൈക്കൽ ക്യാൻസറിന്റെ ഇൻസിഡൻസ് കേരളത്തിൽ കുറഞ്ഞത്. അൺലൈക്ക് വെസ്റ്റേൺ പോപ്പുലേഷൻ, ഈ നമ്മുടെ ഈ ഫോൾ ഇൻ സെർവൈക്കൽ ക്യാൻസർ ഇൻസിഡൻസ് ഇസ് ജസ്റ്റ് ബിക്കോസ് ഓഫ് അവർ സോഷ്യോ എക്കണോമിക് ഗ്രോത്ത്, പാരിറ്റി കുറഞ്ഞു, ഏജ് ഓഫ് മാരേജ് കൂടി, അങ്ങനെ കുറെ അൺറിലേറ്റഡ് ഫാക്ടേഴ്സ് നമ്മുടെ സൊസൈറ്റിയുടെ ഒരു ഒരു സിറ്റുവേഷൻ മാറിയ കാരണം വന്നൊരു ചേഞ്ച് ആണ്. വിച്ച് സെയിം തിങ് ഹാപ്പൻ ഇൻ ചൈന, ബട്ട് വാട്ട് ചൈന വിറ്റ്നസ്ഡ് വാസ് ദാറ്റ് ആഫ്റ്റർ സം 10 years എച്ച് പി വി കെയിം ബാക്ക് ആൻഡ് ദർ വാസ് അനദർ സ്പൈക്ക് ഇൻ സെർവൈക്കൽ ക്യാൻസർ ഇൻസിഡൻസ്. അപ്പൊ നമ്മൾ അതിന് വെയിറ്റ് ചെയ്യാതെ ഇപ്പോഴത്തെ 15 താഴെയുള്ള യങ് ഗേൾസിന് വി ഷുഡ് സ്റ്റാർട്ട് വാക്സിനേറ്റിംഗ് നൗ. വാക്സിനേഷന് എതിരെ വാക്സിനേഷനെ കുറിച്ച് ഒരുപാട് മിസ് തോട്ട്സ് ഉണ്ട്.
കുറച്ച് പോസ്റ്റേഴ്സ് ഉണ്ടാക്കി കേഫോഗിന്റെ വകയായിട്ട് പലയിടത്തും അത് എക്സിബിറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുമോ? ഓപിയിലൊക്കെ
നമ്മൾ ചെയ്യണം, ബിക്കോസ് ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റും പീഡിയാട്രീഷ്യൻസും തന്നെ ഈ വാക്സിനെ കുറിച്ച് കൺസേൺഡ് ആണ്. ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മളൊരു ഒരു വർഷം കൊണ്ട് ഉണ്ടാക്കിയെടുത്ത കോവിഡ് വാക്സിൻ എടുത്തവരാണ് നമ്മളെല്ലാരും. പിന്നെ ഇത് ഈ പർട്ടിക്കുലർ എച്ച് പി വി വാക്സിൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് ടൈം ടെസ്റ്റഡ്. ഇതിന് ഇത്രയധികം മാക്സിമം വർക്ക്, ഐ മീൻ റിസർച്ച് ഹാസ് ബീൻ ഡൺ ഫോർ എച്ച് പി വി വാക്സിൻ. സോ സേഫ് ആണോ എന്ന് ചോദിച്ചാൽ ഇറ്റ്സ് ലൈക്ക് എനി അതർ വാക്സിൻ. ദർ ഇസ് എ സ്മോൾ പെർസെന്റേജ് ഓഫ് അഡ്വേഴ്സ് എഫക്ട്സ്, ബട്ട് വിച്ച് ഷുഡൻറ് പ്രൊഹിബിറ്റ് അസ് ഫ്രം യൂസിംഗ് ദ വാക്സിൻ. അപ്പൊ വാക്സിൻ വാക്സിനേഷൻ പ്രോഗ്രാം ഷുഡ് കം ഫ്രം ദ ഗവൺമെന്റ് സൈഡ്, ബട്ട് ഷുഡ് ബി സപ്പോർട്ടഡ് ബൈ ഈച്ച് ആൻഡ് എവറി ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റ് ആൻഡ് പീഡിയാട്രീഷ്യൻസ്. പീഡിയാട്രീഷ്യൻസിന്റെ ഫാലസി എന്താന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ ദേ ആർ നോട്ട് സീയിങ് ദ സെർവൈക്കൽ ക്യാൻസർ. വി ആർ സീയിങ് ദ സെർവൈക്കൽ ക്യാൻസർ, ബട്ട് ദ പോപ്പുലേഷൻ ഹു ഹാസ് ടു ബി വാക്സിനേറ്റഡ് കംസ് ഇൻ ദ പീഡിയാട്രിക് ഏജ് ഗ്രൂപ്പ് ലെസ് ഇൻ 50. സോ അവർക്ക് അതിന്റെ ഒരു നീഡിനെ കുറിച്ച് ദേ ആർ നോട്ട് കൺവിൻസ്ഡ്. സോ ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റ് മുഴുവൻ അവയർ ആയി കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ടേ നമുക്ക് അടുത്ത പീഡിയാട്രീഷ്യൻസിനെ കൺവിൻസ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ഈ വാക്സിൻ ഷുഡ് കം ആസ് എ പ്രോഗ്രാം ഇൻ ദ വാക്സിനേഷൻ. അവൈലബിലിറ്റി ഇസ് നോട്ട് എൻ ഇഷ്യൂ. ഈവൻ ദ നാനോവാലന്റ് ഇസ് ഗെറ്റിംഗ് ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ്ഡ് ഇൻ ഇന്ത്യ ഇൻ എ ഫ്യൂ മന്ത്സ്. നാനോവാലന്റ് ഈ വർഷം തന്നെ വരുന്നാ പറഞ്ഞത്, മെയിൽ റിലീസ് ചെയ്യുന്ന പറഞ്ഞു, ബട്ട് ഷുഡ് കം ഇൻ 2021 ഇറ്റ്സെൽഫ്. സോ വാക്സിൻ അവൈലബിലിറ്റി ഇസ് നോട്ട് എൻ ഇഷ്യൂ, ബട്ട് പ്രാക്ടീസ് ഇസ് നോട്ട് ദേർ. അഡ്മിഷൻ ഉണ്ടെന്ന് പറയുന്നത് എനിത്തിങ്, പക്ഷെ ഇത്രയും വാക്സിൻ ഇപ്പൊ ഇന്ത്യയിലെ വാക്സിൻ ഉണ്ടാക്കുന്ന ഫെസിലിറ്റീസ് തന്നെ കൂടി, ഇന്ത്യയുടെ പൂനെയിലെ വാക്സിന്റെ ഫേസ് 3 ട്രയൽ ഇസ് ഓൾമോസ്റ്റ് ഓവർ. എല്ലാം കോവിഡ് കാരണം ഒരു സ്റ്റാൻഡ് സ്റ്റിൽ നിന്നതാണ്. സോ ഇന്ത്യൻ വാക്സിൻ ഷുഡ് കം ആൻഡ് കോസ്റ്റ് ഇഷ്യൂ ഓൾസോ ഗോ ഡൗൺ. മീൻ വൈൽ വിൽ സെൻസിറ്റൈസ് അവർ ഗൈനക്കോളജിസ്റ്റ് ദാറ്റ് ദിസ് വാക്സിൻ ഇസ് ഗുഡ്. സ്ക്രീനിങ് ഷുഡ് ബി ഡൺ ആൻഡ് കോൾപോസ്കോപ്പി ഷുഡ് ബി ഡൺ ആൻഡ് all the simple treating programs to CIN should be practiced by each and every gynecologist in the state. So adu nammude foxine oru motto ayittu eduthittu nammal aa oru idedukanam
public awareness korchada ellarum cheyyunnarikkunnalle public awareness valare koravana nammal ippa kaliyunnathra ore group ne nokkiyitte public awareness kodukkale korchu ingane ore societies unda Rotary Lions അങ്ങനെയുള്ളവർക്കൊന്നും വാക്സിൻ എടുക്കാൻ വലിയ ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടുണ്ടാവും എന്ന് എനിക്ക് തോന്നുന്നില്ല സ്ക്രീനിങ്ങിന്റെ. അപ്പൊ നമുക്ക് കഴിയുന്നിടത്ത് നമുക്ക് എല്ലാവർക്കും അങ്ങനെ മാക്സിമം പബ്ലിക് അവയർനെസ് കൊടുത്താലേ ഇത് കുറച്ചുകൂടെ ഒരു ഒന്നോ രണ്ടോ പേര് ചെയ്തിട്ട് കാര്യമില്ല, എല്ലാവരും കൂടെ അതിന് വേണ്ടി പരിശ്രമിക്കുന്നതായിരിക്കും. അപ്പൊ ഇത് പോകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്ന എല്ലാവരും ഒന്ന് ട്രൈ ചെയ്യുക, മാക്സിമം നമുക്ക് ഒന്ന് കളയാൻ എലിമിനേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ വേണ്ടിയിട്ട്. വാക്സിൻസ് ആണെങ്കിൽ വാക്സിൻ ആണെങ്കിൽ അവൈലബിൾ ആണ്, എച്ച് പി വി ടെസ്റ്റ് ആണ് അവൈലബിൾ ആണ്, കോൾപോസ്കോപ്പി എനിക്ക് എല്ലാ ഡിസ്ട്രിക്റ്റിലും ഉണ്ടെന്ന കാര്യം അറിയണ്ടായിരുന്നില്ല. പക്ഷെ നമുക്ക് വേണമെങ്കിൽ അതിനെല്ലാം നമുക്ക് ഇതാക്കാൻ പറ്റും, ട്രെയിനിങ് കൊടുക്കാനും അതിനെല്ലാം സൗകര്യം ഉണ്ട്. അപ്പം കഴിയുന്നത്ര ഒന്ന് പരിശ്രമിക്കുകയട്ടെ.
Thank you.
Before concluding, I cordially invite all of you for the virtual marathon which we are organizing on tomorrow morning at 6 a.m. between 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. You can download Strava app from the Google Store, or if you are using Apple Watch, you can use it. Or many people will be using the health fitness watches, so you can use it. It is between 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. Dr. Ajit Kayafoji, president, will be inaugurating, and that will mark the end of our Earth Day to Environment Day activities. We had a poster competition involving most of the hospitals in Malappuram district. We had quiz competition, and we'll be releasing our Pranayam newsletter. That is a journal that is in love with nature. So that will be publishing almost 60 articles by our members who have actively involved in environment protection activities during the past 1 year. So last year issue that was available in Amazon, and that was we could sell a lot of issues through Amazon. So cordially invite all of you, all the delegates, faculty, all of you, I invite for tomorrow's virtual marathon. Thank you.
Thank you. இப்போதே எனக்கு வலிங்க ஐடியா தான.
Good night, ma'am.
Again, very good.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank
nice
you.
Seeing all of you.
Thank you, madam.
Bye. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.